wow. The Parkes Radio Telescope here in Australia is most famous for receiving pictures from the Apollo 11 moonwalk, but it's still in near constant use for astronomy and scientific research. Now, it's a maintenance day here today, which is why I'm allowed to be here on the surface of the dish. And the dish is about to tilt over nearly all the way to touching the ground. And I'm going to be here while it happens. I'm going for a ride. But that would be a lot of very slow, boring footage of me just awkwardly standing and sitting here as my world tilts over. So while that's happening, let me show you how I got here. I'm going to be filming this awkwardly. We've got John here who's going to show me around. We've got Jack behind the camera. Let's go see a telescope.
Yeah, let's go in, Tom, and see what it's like inside.
You can tell it was built in the 60s and 70s, can't you? Big asbestos warning.
This is the ground floor where we have the air conditioning units that help keep all our electronics cool.
And the astronomers, presumably.
And the astronomers too. Just behind Jackie, we have the most important room in the building, which is the astronomers' kitchen. If they do visit, they can stay on site. But over the last 10 years, we've switched to a remote observing regime where people can log in over the internet to observe. So we have fewer and fewer astronomers visiting now. But let's go on upstairs and have a look in the main control room. So follow me on that.
This is so weird because the clouds are rotating. I know the dish is rotating, but I cannot see anything.
So this is the old control room. The old control desk that was recreated for the film The Dish used to be located about there. But in 1982, it was decommissioned and replaced by a computerized desk that used the PDP-11 computers. It doesn't crash very often because it doesn't have an operating system. It just stays up very reliably. And so we still use it to drive the dish around and to point the telescope too. If it's not broken, we're not fixing it. The radio waves coming down from the stars, they're reflected off the parabolic surface of the dish and they're brought to the focus where the radio waves are concentrated. We can typically collect a few terabytes of data a day, but with the new receivers that we're commissioning later this year, we'll be looking at maybe 9 terabytes an hour. The telescope itself is an extremely sensitive radio detector because the energies that we're collecting from the stars are incredibly weak. If I was to release the feather and let it slowly just drift to the floor here like this, the energy that feather expended when it struck the floor was more than all the energy ever collected by every radio telescope ever built in terms of the astronomical data. And so that's why radio telescopes have to be so large, because you want as large a collecting area as possible. Any electronic devices will transmit radio waves that could very easily overwhelm the really feeble signals we're trying to detect, such as mobile phones.
Well, such as these wireless mics, by the way. It's a maintenance day. I got special permission for these.
That's right. A lot of this equipment we've designed ourselves, but we also have other equipment that we buy off the shelf, and there we have to put them in shielded cabinets because they're not really designed to be radio quiet, so to speak. A mobile telephone on the moon's surface, 400,000 kilometers away, would be one of the brightest radio sources in the sky for us.
Okay.
So if we can detect it from the moon, we have no trouble detecting it from the car park. We refer to this as the master control panel. If I was to turn this off here, you can see it's on remote. It'll be on computer control so that people off site can log in, take control and move the telescope. But if I was to put it on to local and master control, I'll be able to move it using these dials up and down.
Wait, the dials still work?
Oh yeah.
Oh. Oh. Okay. Gravity is changing direction. We gotta walk this way. I guess we gotta stay horizontal here. I'm not actually sure what horizontal is anymore. Am I still? No, I think I need to go further. I'm not horizontal yet. I've got no reference frame. I can't see the horizon. I can't see anything. This is dizzying.
Because we observe remotely now, often there's nobody in the tower when we're observing, and so we need a way to make sure the telescope's safe at all times. So we have this device called the Telescope Protection System, or TPS, which monitors hundreds of data points on the telescope, and if it detects an issue that might be a problem, it immediately alerts us using SMS messages, emails, telexes, everything, and we can immediately descend on the telescope, see what's wrong and fix it. And we have an anemometer. As soon as the wind reaches a certain critical speed, that's when we say the winds are too high and we just stow the telescope. Because essentially the telescope's just a giant beach umbrella.
I mean, this thing's incredibly robust. It's held up to significant wind and weather.
When it was commissioned back in October 1961, it was only intended to operate for 20 years. So we're now 41 years over that. And the reason for this is because we've continually upgraded the telescope. The most obvious upgrades have been to the dish surface.
I'm not going to do anything, but suddenly I'm not walking on a solid surface, I'm walking on the mesh of the dish, and my brain is just about dealing with it.
We're going up into the dish surface here, so we're first going up through the spiral staircase in the central column. This central column is on a separate foundation to the rest of the building, because at the top of the this column is the master ecotore, the device that helps us point the telescope accurately. So we don't want that connected to the rest of the building, because the vibrations will cause the pointings of the telescope to be out.
Wow.
So
okay,
come on up.
So all the cables here are transmission cables?
That's right, yeah. They're bringing signals down from the focus cabin, and also we send other commands up to operate the equipment and power it and so on also. Okay.
I just looked over and there's a horizon all of a sudden.
We're now going to go through the door down to the azimuth track building.
Right, okay. Oh, yeah, I just looked up. There's a telescope up there.
Before we go all the way down, you can see this is the twister room. The cables coming down from the focus cabin come down here first. There are two counter-rotating rings. So as the dish rotates in azimuth, they counter-rotate. So they take up the slack and release it so that the cables don't get twisted and tangled or anything.
Oh,
like
that's
that.
Very clever.
So this level is what we call the azimuth track. And this is the actual azimuth track. And if you look here, you can see it's sitting on four rollers, but only two are driven. On this track, we move it left and right like this. But you can see in the center there's nothing actually holding it down. It's just pivoted there. It's just the sheer weight of the structure that keeps the telescope grounded.
Oh, wow.
Because everything from this level on up weighs 1,000 tons, or the equivalent of 3 fully laden jumbo jets.
Yeah, okay. All right.
So when they built the telescope back in the 50s, they didn't have computers that could do the coordinate conversions fast enough. So instead, Barnes Wallis, a very famous British engineer, he came up with this device, essentially said, it's an optical telescope, and because that's the polar axis, once you point the optical telescope to the position you want on the sky, you only have to move it at a constant rate around the polar axis so that you could then follow the object smoothly across the
You're
sky.
You're adjusting for the Earth's rotation by just rotating something at the same angle in the opposite direction.
And this was the secret to the telescope's success. We were able to point the telescope very, very accurately on the sky. In fact, it was so successful that all subsequent large single dish antennas employed a master ecotore up until about the 1990s, when the microprocessors were small enough and fast enough to do the coordinate conversions on the fly. Before we go up, let's have a walk around the superstructure just under the dish. So, here we go.
You're walking around here a lot more casually than I am.
Oh, okay. You can see here, this is a great view. You can see out towards the east where we have the Harvey Ranges that shield us from the radio emissions from the larger population centers further east.
Right.
This is one of the reasons why it was chosen. It's very radio quiet.
All right. So next stop.
Yeah. We'll go around. We'll keep going around. And then we'll end up where we started.
If you just turn the camera around that way for a moment, that's where I was standing a moment ago, was in the middle of that dish. This ride I'm taking isn't just a gimmick. It's called a hayride sometimes, but it turns out that's a term that was invented by Americans for a film that was shot here more than 20 years ago. The folks at Parks actually just call this riding the dish, and they use it to get heavy equipment in and out of the central part, because it's a lot easier to let the dish do the lifting instead of trying to actually lug bulky gear through all the corridors and stairwells inside. Two hands on the railing, and we're down. Thank you very much, folks. Thank you, Jack.